Hi everybody, it's Rishi Agarwal, and in this video, I want to take you back almost 100 years to talk about one of the seminal papers in radiology. But let me set the stage a little bit. The year is 1892, and the son of a prominent Quaker family just graduates from Friends Central High School. I looked this place up in Google Maps, and it's still there. It's a private high school in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania. Now, he wants to go on to medical school, but both of his parents die unexpectedly, and he's forced to take a job as a bank teller for 2 years. He then gets into the University of Pennsylvania Med School, and this is without doing any pre-med education in undergrad. So basically, he goes straight from high school into med school. Now, I'm not sure how common that was back in the day, but today it's pretty unheard of, so he must have been pretty smart. After he finishes med school, he graduates and does his internship at the same hospital, University Hospital in Philadelphia. And then he gets a job as assistant professor of surgery in the year 1900. A couple years later, the head of the Department of Radiology retires, a guy named Dr. Leonard. And the chief of surgery, Dr. White, asks the young surgeon to take over the new job as the head of radiology. So this young surgeon takes on the job of head of radiology in 1902, and he really flourishes. In 1911, he becomes the first full professor of radiology, apparently in the whole country at the time. He goes on to many more accolades. He is the president of the American Board of Radiology. He becomes the president of the American College of Radiology. But none of those things are the reason why most of you know his name today. The reason why most of us know his name today is because of two papers that he wrote in 1924 and 1932. And in those papers, he talks about an unusual tumor at the apex of the chest that causes symptoms in the arm and in the eye. And of course, this man's name was Henry Pancoast, and we call these tumors Pancoast tumors. So let's take a look at those two papers. Here's the first paper, which was published in JAMA in 1924. It's entitled Importance of Careful Roentgen Ray Investigations of Apical Chest Tumors. And he writes, there is an unusual but apparently infrequent type of intrathoracic growth occurring in the apical region. The neoplastic condition is unusual for the reason that it produces referred nerve phenomena in the upper extremity, and when to these manifestations are added certain cervical sympathetic phenomena, the symptomatology of spinal cord tumor is closely simulated. So in other words, these patients have tumors of the upper chest that simulate tumors of the spine, and it causes symptoms in the arm like pain and numbness and tingling, and it also causes symptoms in the eye, specifically Horner syndrome. Now, Pancoast doesn't use the term Horner syndrome in this paper, but he does in the subsequent paper. Now remember, Horner syndrome is due to involvement of the sympathetic chain on one side, and it causes meiosis, which is contraction of the pupil, ptosis, which is depression of the superior eyelid, and lack of sweating on one side of the face. That's called anhidrosis. In this paper, Pancoast goes over 5 patient cases. Let's take a look at the first one. This is a man, age 52, and his chief complaint was intense burning pain high in the left axilla, extending down the arm, and on admission, there was a contracted left pupil, an ophthalmos, and narrowing of the palpebral fissure. An ophthalmos is when the eye sinks into the socket, and it's something that you can also see in patients with Horner syndrome, although it's not as common as those 3 other things. Narrowing of the palpebral fissure is usually due to depression of the eyelid. The patient brought with him some films of the spine, which were said to have been regarded as negative, and in this we concurred. That's really interesting to me, because he's very candid about missing this finding on the initial study. But then he also writes, it's important to note, however, that the films were very dense. So already radiologists back in the 1920s were hedging based on the quality of the films. A little further down, it says, Roentgen ray examination was made 5 days later, and we discovered a shadow in the extreme left apex and destruction of the posterior portions of the left second and third ribs and adjacent corresponding transverse processes. And then he says, a 50 milligram radium tube was implanted in the growth and 7 needles around the periphery for 19 hours. So he made the diagnosis, the patient had surgery, and then he also implanted radiation tubes in order to treat the tumor. The pathology report says that it was an endothelial carcinoma of the pleura, which is not really a term that we use today, but I think he was talking about a hemangioendothelioma of the pleura, which is a pretty rare tumor. Let's take a look at the patient images. So unfortunately, the images are pretty bad, and I think part of that has to do with it being reproduced in a journal, but I would really like to see what these actually look like in real life. So note that this is flipped. This image is not how we normally look at images, with the right being on the left and the left being on the right. In this case, the patient's right is over here and the patient's left is over here. And you can see that in this area, there's an asymmetric opacity and you lose the definition of the second and third ribs because they're being eroded by tumor. I want to draw your attention to another part of this paper that I thought was really funny, and that's down in case 4, where Pankos writes about a man, aged 61, who was referred to me in April 1920 for examination for possible cervical rib. There was no cervical rib, but I called attention incidentally to a circumscribed area of increased density in the right apical region. Evidently, this portion of my report was not taken seriously. So you could tell that Pankos was salty about this interaction, and he doesn't write more about it, but I would really love to know what actually happened there. Did the primary care physician see the report and just dismiss the findings, or did he not look at the report at all? I don't know. And that actually brings up a good point, and that is a problem that happens to us even today in modern radiology. We make recommendations, and sometimes those recommendations aren't carried out by the primary care physician. But I thought that that was funny that he was dealing with that back in 1924. Now, let me show you a couple aspects of the second paper. So the second paper was published in 1932. It was also in JAMA. The title of the paper was Superior Pulmonary Sulcus Tumor, Tumor Characterized by Pain, Horner Syndrome, Destruction of Bone, and Atrophy of Hand Muscles. And in the third paragraph, he writes, it has been found advisable to discard the name of apical chest tumor as a designation for this growth because it has proved to be confusing and has permitted the inclusion of other more common tumors in the upper part of the thorax. The name of superior pulmonary sulcus tumor has been given to it because this term implies its approximate location and a lack of origin from the lung, pleura, ribs, or mediastinum. It is possible that this new designation may be changed again with a better knowledge of the histopathology of the growth. Now, he was right about that second part because we don't really use the term superior pulmonary sulcus tumor anymore. That's sort of an out-of-date term. And what he got wrong about this was he ascribed these tumors to something outside of the lung, pleura, ribs, or mediastinum. He thought it was something separate from those areas, when in fact we know that most of the tumors that cause these symptoms in the arm and in the eye are actually from primary lung tumors. And the way we describe these tumors now, instead of saying superior pulmonary sulcus tumor, we talk about the origin of the tumor. So a lung cancer at the lung apex or a pleural tumor at the apex of the right or left hemithorax. We don't really use that term superior pulmonary sulcus tumor anymore. In the second paper, Pankos puts forth a hypothesis that these tumors are coming from embryonal epithelial rests, which turns out to not be the case. And actually, he was a little bit more accurate in his first paper, because in his first paper, one of the things that he wrote was, I do not wish to imply that diffuse infiltrating endothelioma of the pleura is the only growth in the apical region that will produce the same symptom complex, including cervical sympathetic paralysis, as in the first three cases reported. The following case may serve to prove that such a contention is not correct. So it, actually, in the first paper, he's leaving open the possibility that tumors of multiple different origins can cause the same symptoms, whereas in the second paper, he ascribes them specifically to these embryonal cell tumors, which is incorrect. So that's probably the biggest thing that he got wrong with these two papers, but he got a couple of huge things right. And the first is just a mode of thinking about the diagnosis through the lens of anatomy and radiology. So a patient comes with these symptoms, then he knows that he should be looking at the apex because the tumor can invade the brachial plexus, causing arm symptoms. The tumor can invade the sympathetic chain, causing the ocular symptoms. So he knows, based on the patient's symptoms and his knowledge of anatomy, where to look on the radiologic study. And as radiologists, we think about that, we have that mode of thinking, and we use that all the time. So if a patient has a unilateral vocal cord paralysis, for example, I know where the recurrent laryngeal nerve runs, and I'm going to be looking in those places to look for pathology. So that is really elegantly described in these two papers. The second big thing that Pankos really got right here was that you have to look at everything. So in the conclusion section of his first paper, he wrote that Roentgen ray examinations of the shoulder alone before the appearance of eye manifestations may fail to reveal such a growth, and a wider area should be included in obscure cases. In Roentgen ray examinations of the spine and for cervical ribs, the films should be carefully studied for any increased density in the apex of the lung or for erosion of the upper ribs or adjacent vertebra. So remember that these patients came for suspected tumors of the spine, and he found that the issue was not the spine, but these tumors in the apex of the chest. So you have to really look at everything, not just the thing that the clinician wants you to rule in or out. And that's one of the things that we teach all residents when they first start, that you have to look at the corners of the film, you have to look at the scout images on your CTs, you have to look at the scout images on your MRs so that you don't miss anything that might be very, very important for the patient. So I think you really elaborated that well with these two papers. All right, well, that's it for this video. If you have any questions about this topic or you have something you want to add, leave them in the comments below. Also, I'm going to link to the two papers in the description below, so be sure to check those out. Thanks.